When Dr. Covey was, I need to get that broadcast. Okay, so when Dr. Covey started preparing his book, it was actually as a doctoral dissertation, and he went through more than 200 years of literature, of American literature on how to be successful. Starting from the very early years of American history, there were people writing about how to be successful because we had immediately had a free market system. So while sometimes that related to financial success, it did not always relate to financial success. The very concept that people were self-destined changed the whole paradigm, is what Covey would call it, the whole entire paradigm of how people saw themselves and saw how they lived. Before that, they lived under kings. With each country, they had an official religion. If they did anything overt to object to the religion, they'd be considered a traitor to their country because it was their official religion. And this wasn't just one religion, it was and one country, it was all the countries of the world pretty much had an official religion. It was so the country, the government and the country, and within the government, most of them had a king or somebody in that position, and he claimed the right to be king, that everybody should follow him because he was of royal blood and he had the right to be king and to tell them what to do. But when people from all the countries, one of the reasons why many of them went to America was to escape that. Many of them were from religions that were not popular. They had no country where their religion controlled it. And so to have religious freedom, they had to go to America. To get away from the kings, to be able to not have noblemen already, always telling them what to do, the lords and all these different levels of royalty telling them what to do, they had to go to America. And so they did. And so the entire paradigm of how people lived was different. And so one of the founding fathers named Benjamin Franklin, one of the first books written in America was essentially How to Be Successful. And that was by itself a new paradigm, a new way of looking, part of a new conceptual framework that we can decide our own future. We can decide whether we can be a success because we don't have noblemen over us. We don't have a king over us. We don't have a church telling us what we have to do and can't do. It was a religious society, but it was a very pluralistic society. There were some concentrations of different churches in different places, but they had to be tolerant of each other, because different states were dominated by different churches and they realized they had to get along, especially when it came to seeking freedom from Great Britain. And so it was a totally different perspective in life. And right from the very start, as I said, among the founding fathers were people who wrote about how to be successful in a free market, in a free country, where you could improve yourself, where you could achieve high standing with your own hard work, your own ingenuity, because there was no nobility system there. There was no king. There was no hierarchy to keep you down. And so Dr. Covey started reading all of the success literature from the very early days, including, like I say, the founding fathers of the country. And after studying hundreds of books, he saw that there had been a big change in how they were teaching and what they were teaching. In the first 150 years of the country, they taught that success was an inside-out approach, that you had to change yourself, you had to be a better person. You didn't have to just act like a good person, you had to be a good person in order to succeed. That you had to have integrity, you had to have, a work ethic, you had to have even things like, not just super things like courtesy, but a genuine interest in other people, a concern for other people. And so, you know, those were kind of inside out things. You become a better person, you will be more successful. And certainly there are ways of expressing that and showing that you were that person, that you were truly a person somebody might want to do business with, that somebody might want to be around. But it was still focused on an inside out process. What you will make yourself, what you will become, then you can succeed. But about 50 years into the American experiment, suddenly he noticed a change in the success literature. And suddenly it was kind of a very superficial sort of thing, a somewhat manipulative thing, where you act this way, you will be successful. It doesn't matter whether you are that way, but if you act sincere, you'll be successful. If you act friendly, you'll be successful. If you act, you know, and it goes through all these, they give you skills about how to act so you could become successful. But it was all very superficial. And so as he started analyzing this and thinking about this, he started questioning why the change and whether it was a good change, and came to the conclusion in his own mind that it was not a good change, that we had lost something important. Authors he read said, there is no real excellence in all the world which can be separated from right living. In other words, saying you have, for you to be really excellent, for you to be successful, it has to be inside out. You have to be a certain kind of person. You have to be somebody who lives by high principles. This for him was, in itself, a paradigm shift. What is a paradigm? Anybody know what a paradigm is? I've used that word already a couple of times. Anybody have a clue what that word is, what it means? Feel free to offer your guesses or your knowledge. A paradigm is basically the way you see the world. It can be seen, we talked earlier about scientific revolutions. For example, in the Civil War, that was in 1860, starting in 1860, it was the North against the South, so it was an internal war, primarily over slavery, not totally over slavery, that's simplistic, but we'll call it the fight over slavery. But in that war, 800,000 Americans died, the most deadly war that America has ever been involved in. And, of course, it was American against American. But most of them did not die of wounds they suffered in the war, at least not directly. Most of them died basically from infections, because in 1860, people still didn't understand germs. They didn't understand how necessary it was to have a sanitary place, hospital, if you would, and in the war zone, it's sometimes hard to do that, but they didn't understand the necessity of having a sterile, sanitary place for the wounded. And so the wound might be, you know, just a grazing shot in the leg, and they'd die from it. And that was true for centuries before that, millennia before that. Before they understood germs, a lot of women would die in childbirth, not from bearing a child, but from unsanitary conditions and resulting infections and so forth. So many of the deaths in the world before, I think germ theory was developed just not too long after the American Civil War. So a decade or two after that, suddenly they understood, or it's almost exactly right about that time, they were studying and understanding what germs were. This was an important paradigm shift. Suddenly people saw medicine in a totally different way once they understood the science of germs. By the way, every place does not have does not fully understand that. My wife, I think I mentioned the other day, my wife is from Kazakhstan, and there they are convinced, not just in Kazakhstan, but much of the former Soviet Union, that if you drink a cold drink, you can catch a cold. And so no matter how much I laugh at her and try to explain to her that it has almost no effect, I mean, basically, a cold drink will go into your stomach, and your stomach will have to maybe warm it up a little bit. It'll take a little bit of energy away from other parts of your body to warm itself back up again. But that a little amount of energy is taking from you. Yes, it can't then employ that energy against germs or against something, you know, for other purposes. But a cold drink warming up in your stomach does not take much energy. But nonetheless, when she got her cold today, she forgot about the fact that her son had had a cold for a week, and he was spreading his germs all around our apartment building. And instead, she said, it was because I drank that cold drink, I got a cold. So some people still don't quite grasp the importance of the germ theory. They have, along with that, is this sense of this notion of a paradigm shift. Sometimes when you realize something, and hopefully you've all gone through this experience yourselves, that sometimes when you gain a new paradigm, when you suddenly understand something, it's kind of, we call it sometimes the aha experience. You inside, you say, aha, now I understand. I love aha experiences. I very, very frequently watch videos about quantum physics, because quantum physics right now is kind of the cutting edge of science, and it is filled with aha experiences. They're very confused about our existence. Some of them even suggest there are very serious scientists, including award-winning scientists, who seriously discuss on YouTube videos whether we really exist, or whether we're somebody else's video game, basically. Our existence is, there's so many things being discovered in quantum physics that it is boggling the scientists' minds, where you're getting all sorts of theories now. But anyway, that when you come up with a new insight as to what is reality, it can be a little bit kind of a high, kind of like a drug, aha, you know, it's a emotional experience can be. And so I love those emotional experiences and love finding aha moments and finding and experiencing paradigm shift. The paradigm itself, you might say, is Covey compares it to a map. That if you are trying to go someplace, let's say you have someplace you need to go in Singapore, and you haven't been there before, and so you get a map, and you're going to drive there, but somebody's made a mistake. The publisher made a mistake, and they really didn't give you a map of Singapore. They gave you a map of, a city in Indonesia or someplace. And so you've tried to follow this map to get to where you want to go in Singapore, and you, no matter how much positive attitude you have, no matter how hard you work, you may not get to where you want to go in Singapore because you don't have the right map. And so just like whatever theories they had before the germ theory did not work because they weren't accurate. And so they had hundreds of thousands of people probably around the world, millions of people dying every year because they didn't understand germs. So whatever paradigm they had before that was not working. No matter how positive attitude they have, no matter how hard they worked, until they understood germs, they could not prevent those deaths. So that is true with any paradigm. A paradigm is the way we see the life. It's not real. It's not reality. The paradigms you have in your head, some of them are fairly accurate probably, and some of them are probably not. Class I taught about conceptual framework in our mind, how we piece things together from an early age. It's like the erector set that I played with when I was a child, a little long, you know, little pieces of metal with holes in them and bolts and nuts that you'd piece them together, and you can make Eiffel Towers or buildings or bridges and stuff. And the more you piece them together, more pieces, the more little pieces you could fit in there. Now, they're all different lengths of metal, so some long, some short, and so forth. And the more pieces you could fit together, the stronger that structure became. Our minds are like that. And so we have a conceptual framework where we've pieced in concepts. And the older we get, the more rigid that conceptual framework is. I mentioned there's a book written by Thomas Kuhn, which all scientists have read, because it was really kind of gave some of these insights as to how scientific revolutions occur. But one thing he noted is that usually scientific revolutions begin with a young person who does not have a rigid conceptual framework yet, who isn't so bought into a paradigm that he can't break out of it. He can't have a paradigm shift because he's still flexible mentally. And so it is important to find correct paradigms. Dr. Covey's own research gave him a paradigm shift. He noticed these 150 years of inside-out success literature, and the last 50 years where suddenly they were teaching superficial solutions to people's problems. That gave him a paradigm shift. And his book gave the world a paradigm shift. His book, like I said, if you're making $500 million a year on your teachings and your books and your CDs and DVDs, you're pretty successful. And he was extremely successful. And so many of the ideas he talks about in his book, you will hear them referring to things like that. You will hear, now that you understand the word paradigm, you'll hear the word paradigm used a lot more. Not before Dr. Covey. You very rarely heard the word used before Dr. Covey. Other things also, other terms that he will use, like synergy. Synergy is a word that was not used very much before Dr. Covey. You'll now hear lots of people referring to synergy. Synergy is when 1 + 1 does not equal 2. The whole is greater than the sum of its parts. A quick example of that is marriage. If you have babies, that's 1 + 1 does not equal 2. May equal 3, 4, 5, 6, 20, whatever. But in an organizational setting, 1 + you have all of your people involved in your organization, and if you get together and if the management trusts the employees to share their ideas, and if the employees feel empowered to make a change in their company, then suddenly you get new ideas that can be extremely valuable to the company. And they would not have come about except through this synergy that you created in your organization. And so that's one of the things, again, that Dr. Covey talks about. So the paradigm is how we see the world. It's not just, in fact, I would say there's probably another bullet item there. It's how we perceive it. In fact, if you, your paradigm can keep you from seeing things. If, for example, again, my wife, she does not see that when she gets into a crowded bus, that she is exposing herself to everybody's germs. In Kazakhstan, buses are extremely packed. They pack them in until there's somebody pressing against you on all sides. I would joke that there you could get AIDS without any sex because you're so packed in. So she rides the buses in Kazakhstan all the time. I would rather walk 4 miles. I mean, I do it for my health anyway, but one part of my health is don't get exposed to all those germs. And so I get the exercise and I avoid the germs. And she doesn't quite understand, again, to her, that's not how colds are created. And so as much as I try to explain and change her paradigm, she just still doesn't quite get it. So how you see the world, she does not look in that bus and be pressed on all sides of the bus and see people's germs. basically. I do. I go in and I see nothing but germs, 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 especially when people start sneezing and coughing. I'm just seeing germs all over the place because that's my paradigm. I may be paranoid about germs because of my paradigm, but she's oblivious to it. And so you, whether you even perceive that there's a threat, for example, and how you understand it and how you interpret it, and then how the fourth bullet should be, what you do about it. This your perception, your understanding, and your interpretation leads to your action. And so depending on your paradigm, you are interpreting the world around you. In the, as you know, and well, the first person who suggested, at least in, that we know of, there's a guy named, and I'm not sure if I pronounce his name right even, Ptolemy from Egypt was the one who concluded by looking at the stars moving in the sky and stuff that all the stars and planets revolved around the Earth. That to him was obvious because he could watch them moving and the next day they'd be back again and so forth. So it was obvious to him that the stars and planets were revolving around the Earth. He didn't understand that the Earth itself was revolving. He couldn't feel it. He couldn't perceive it. So to him, obviously, everything else was revolving around us. It was Copernicus, I think, that then came to the realization that we were revolving around the sun and the Earth itself was revolving centuries later. So people saw things very differently when they went through that scientific revolution. There was... Newton was able to explain a lot about gravity and other principles, but Einstein took it a step further. And so for scientists, Newton's laws are pretty good for the average person. But when you become, a high-level scientist, you're more concerned about what Einstein had to say than Newton, because what Einstein had to say was more precise, and it helps you understand reality a little bit better. So each change in perception changes how these things change. It changes, again, starts with perception, on to understanding, interpretation, and ultimately action. How do we do in response to our version of reality? And again, those paradigms exist not just in science and religion and family life. There are some religions where including my wife, again, going back to her as an example, my wife's husband, first husband, used to beat her all the time. That the thinking in Kazakhstan is that so that if your wife makes you unhappy, you have the right to beat her. Well, that's not true in America. You go to jail for beating your wife. We have a totally different paradigm in America. You don't beat anybody without possibility of going to jail. Your children, on a limited basis, but there's a degree there where the law would step in and you go to jail for beating your children. So it's a different paradigm than in many other parts of the world where, you can beat the kids all you want to. You can beat your wife if you want to. Anyway, that's why my wife is no longer married to her first husband, though, because she was afraid that she might not survive one of his beatings someday. That perception, in fact, in Central Asia, beyond that, they also have bride kidnappings. You can kidnap a wife. You like somebody, you can kidnap her. A close friend of mine was engaged, and the former boyfriend, his fiance's former boyfriend, kidnapped her. He was able to negotiate to get her back the first time, and so they were going to hurry up and get married, and he kidnapped her again. And I presume he went away. He went ahead and probably, in essence, raped her. And at that point, her family decided not to bring the law in, just to let it go. And so she's now with her, not her preferred husband, but with her former boyfriend. That is a paradigm in Central Asia that happens a lot in Kazakhstan, more in Kyrgyzstan and some of those countries. It's okay. You want somebody, you just kidnap them. And the law does almost nothing about it. So there are paradigms that we live with all the time that we accept as our reality. And then once in a while we have a paradigm shift and we have an aha experience. We change the way we see things. And that's part of what Dr. Covey tries to do in his book, is to give you a paradigm shift of your own to help you realize that you don't have to accept your current reality. Anyway, a simple way to understand paradigms is to see them as maps that I already mentioned. And if you have the wrong map, you're not going to get the road you want to go. And so paradigms are important. They're an important part of our day-to-day. They're kind of like theories, so to speak. Theory rather than reality. So a map is a theory of how to get someplace. It's not reality. It's a theory of reality. Or it's the illustration or somebody's illustration of reality that's not perfect. And so sometimes even with the right map, you may have trouble getting where you want to go. And those with GPS have a lot easier time than those trying to go with an old paper map like I used to have to. So again, paradigms are the source of behavior, and even our attitudes are based on our paradigm. Again, in Kazakhstan, if a man wants to beat his wife, he can. He doesn't feel sorry about it. I mean, he might feel, there might be some impact that his wife's not going to love him as much, obviously, not going to be as sensitive to his needs because he's beaten her, but he feels like he has the right. And so his attitude leads to behaviors that in America would land you in prison. Okay, here's a drawing of a young woman. Some of you may have seen this before. If you have, don't tell anybody else. It's kind of a experiment. How old would you say this woman is? How many think she's 20 or in her 20s, somewhere in her 20s? How many in her 30s? Okay, 40s? Nobody has an opinion. Okay, well, I would say she's youngish, isn't she? She's kind of young. I guess she could even be under 20. I guess I should have started with the teens. She could be in her teens. Obviously, it's just a drawing. So we don't, again, like a map, this isn't reality. It's the drawing of reality. And so we interpret that as being someone who's somewhat young. Okay, here's another drawing. How old is this person? How many people here see a young person in this drawing? Everybody has to vote. How many people here see a young person in this drawing? How many people here see an old person in this drawing? How many people here see both a young person and an old person in this drawing? They both are in this drawing. The experiment that was done more extended fashion at Harvard Business School when Dr. Covey was there, spent a little more time looking at that first one, because that first drawing would kind of lead people to see the young person in this drawing. But this drawing is both a young person and an old person, in a sense. Okay, it's not going to pick up my mouse. If you don't have a laser here, but if you were to, I'll walk away from my computer, my microphone. But the young person, this is her nose, this is her eyelash, this is her ear, this is her chin, this is her neck, some sort of maybe a necklace across, on her neck, going down into her bosom area. If you're looking at the old woman, you see a big nose here, you see her eye, you see her chin coming through down here, her mouth here. But this is drawing two people. A young person and an old person.
Some people have a very hard time, once they get into their mind,
one or the other, they can't see the other one. I perceive you're doing exactly what would be expected, that you're trying to explain to each other where the young person is and where the old person is. Because you can't still, some of you still can't see both of them. As I said, once you get one of them in your mind, it's hard to see the other one. Because one becomes dominant. So this is kind of, you can kind of compare this to paradigms. Once you get something into your head, it's hard for you to perceive something else. You see a young woman, you can't, it's hard to perceive the old woman. If you see the old woman, it's hard for you to perceive the young woman. Because you get something into your head and you see that and it's so clear to you, that it's hard to see the other one. And so it sometimes takes a while before you can see both of them. And it's kind of almost hurts your head a little bit to make yourself see the other one, because one is dominant, and that one is so easy for you to see, and it's so hard for you to see the other one. When you do finally see the other one, as I said, you have kind of an aha experience. Many of you just experienced aha. Many of you just, in realizing the other picture was there, went to yourself, aha, there it is. There's that other picture. That is the aha experience. I think yesterday I did not show this one. Am I going to show this one today? It's only 8 minutes or so. I guess I will. I'm going to put this on pause. I'm not going to blend this into my YouTube video. I'm going to put this on pause, and I'm going to go back to the YouTube and play this video for you to help a little more about understanding paradigms. I'm not sure. It seemed like there was quite a bit of talking during the video, so I'm not sure how much you understood from this. But in essence, what Dr. Christensen is saying is, he was telling a story here. Let me recap really briefly. People like Steve Jobs figured out how to be successful from him. People like, what's his name? Alan Grove, whatever, the head of Intel that does almost all the microprocessors in the world, learned how to compete against future challenges from him. Because what he was explaining here is that what you're typically taught in an MBA program is to be fact-driven and data-driven. But just like the example I gave to you in a previous class relating to Dr. Christensen, when it comes to new technology, there is no data. So when you come across new technology and your company is competing against new technology, you have no data on which to base your decisions. And in fact, as he was explaining, it's almost using normal business strategy, it almost condemns you to death if you follow data, as happened to the hard drive companies. I think I told you about in the previous class. But the 51 companies built hard drives of that size for the original PCs, and when they went to a smaller size, they asked their customers. So they're looking for data. Do you want smaller hard drives? And they all said, no, we're very happy with our big hard drives. And went through another generation. They went to their customers again. Do you want a smaller hard drive? And they still said, oh, we like our current hard drives. And at the end of that process, the companies were producing the big hard drives and knew how to make smaller hard drives, but they didn't, whether or not to invest in actually manufacturing the smaller ones maybe weren't quite as good as the bigger ones at first. So they thought, well, why would we make an inferior product when our people are happy with the big ones? But what the people they surveyed did not know is what they would want in the future. So they could not collect data and base decisions on what people would want in the future. And consequently, of the 51 companies that were building the big hard drives, who had some of the best technologists in the world, who had the money, who had the success, who had the client base. Out of the 51, only three of them survived the transition because they didn't make right decisions. They didn't themselves understand what how the world would suddenly change when you could put a really small hard drive into a laptop, for example, rather than having a big desktop. So they companies have failed because of this. And in some cases, again, he mentioned the car industry. And so right now, the Korean companies, Korean car companies are starting to come after Toyota, which previously went after GM and Ford in America. But basically they're put in a position where these new companies are paying their employees less money. They are putting out a cheaper, not as good a product as we do, but they're getting a market of people who couldn't afford our cars. Do we make cheaper cars, worse cars, at almost a loss because we now pay our workers more money? And do we go after them and try to defend that lowest market? And the common decision has been, no, we let them have that. It's not worth it. We don't make much money off that anyway. And we will lose money going after them because they have lower, they have lower costs than we do. And consequently, those companies they get a niche at the bottom and then they start working their way up. They get better at what they do and they work their way up. And just like Toyota overtook GM and Ford, now Kia is overtaking Toyota and the Chinese manufacturer is going after Kia. And you have this new innovations, new disruptive companies coming in and stealing the market from the established companies, contrary to what would happen, because the established companies have all the advantages, it would seem, except they can't get their minds around the fact that they have to fight that person. Even if they have to lose money to do it, they've got to fight that person at the bottom, coming up to them at the bottom and stealing a very unprofitable market from them. And so Intel decided, once they talked to Dr. Christensen, they had to do whatever they had to do to make sure those companies that were challenging them at the bottom would not be successful. So the way that companies are thinking, has their paradigm has totally changed because of Dr. Christensen. So the idea of paradigm, it is part of our daily lives, whether you're a business manager, whether you're just a family member, whether you're an individual trying to figure out how to be successful. How our paradigms control our lives is important. I already mentioned that. Another cartoon. Not all paradigms are positive. Not all paradigm shifts are positive, such as what Dr. Covey discovered when he's looking at the American success literature. They had all this this inside-out character-based literature in the early days of America, and then they went to the very superficial, somewhat manipulative success literature later on. And the manipulative stuff is not as good as, it's not based on sound principles. And that's the next thing we'd want to talk about is our principles. And I'm going to skip over that. So he believes that there are some principles that are as eternal as the law of gravity. That most churches teach these things. And most people kind of have a sense of them inside. Even if they're bad people, they know they're being bad when they cheat somebody. They have a sense that they're not doing what's right. But they do it anyway because of their selfishness, whatever motive they have. Most people understand that these are correct principles. We have a sense of fairness. Kids tell their parents all the time, "Well, that's not fair. You did this for my brother. Why don't you do it for me?" The sense of fairness is rooted into, you know, from the very earliest ages, kids are talking to their parents about being fair, integrity and honesty, something that we naturally understand as being something that's important. If we're not honest with other people, they'll stop trusting us. So in a success from Covey's perspective, you might be dishonest with somebody and get short-term gain. A long-term gain you will not make, because they will learn that you're not to be trusted. Human dignity, that there's something important. Every individual has a certain has potential to become better. Every individual deserves to be treated with dignity. That is perhaps not as widely spread as some of the principles he talks about, but it is certainly an important part of the American paradigm that says that all people are created equal. Principle of service. Most of us have had a chance to do something for somebody else. It makes us feel good. It helps them. And I know from my own life, being of service to other people is one of the most important parts of my life, is being of service to others. That's why I'm a teacher. Principle of potential, that people can be, can grow, can become better, can achieve much more than what they are doing right now, that everybody has greater potential. So he felt like, again, that the early success literature emphasized these sorts of things, that if we became stronger at these principles, we would be more successful. When we start facing problems, and when we talk about success literature, we're talking about how to overcome problems. That's really what it's all about. Whether it's problems in our personal lives, problems, challenges in our business, our employment, how to be a better salesperson, whatever it is, we're talking about somehow overcoming problems. And Einstein said, the significant problems we face cannot be solved at the same level of thinking we were at when we created them. Many of the problems we face, we created. And though we can't solve them if we keep doing what we did. The definition of insanity is to do the same thing over and over again and expect different results. And so if we're facing challenges that and failing to solve them, maybe it's because we're a little bit insane and we haven't changed our paradigm and we haven't learned new things, new ways of responding to the challenges that we're facing. So as I mentioned, he felt that inside-out change was important. There have been, in America, we have a strong welfare system. And this is just an example, but it's been said you can't not take people out of the slums until you take the slums out of the people. In other words, we have spent billions and billions, probably now trillions of dollars on trying to help the poor people in America. And one of the biggest challenges is that doesn't change them. It feeds them, but it doesn't change them. And so we actually have more poor people in America now than we had when we started the welfare program. Some people become dependent on it. And so they just live to get their welfare check. And they don't take themselves out of the slums, so to speak. They have opportunities to. They have opportunities to go to college, and they don't do it. They have opportunities to go to and learn more from school, and their schools in the inner cities are chaos, that they're not learning anything. And so sometimes, like I say, this it's an inside-out change. You cannot deal with the superficial and expect success. You have to start inside and to do that. So let's talk a little bit about the seven habits and as kind of an overview. We are what we repeatedly do. Excellence, then, is not an act, but a habit, said Aristotle. So there's another saying in America that when you sow a thought, you reap an action. When you sow an action, you reap a habit. And when you sow a habit, you reap a character. And so that's kind of the I think with some truth, it begins with how we think and then how we start acting. Those create habits where we don't have to think anymore about what we do because it's a habit. hopefully a positive habit, and that creates our character, which to me is the most important thing that we have, is our character. To change habits, you first off need to understand what it is that what habit, you know, that habit you want to create. You need to understand what it is, what you're wanting to do, develop some skill in it. Let's say you want to have better relations with other people. You need to understand what does science tell us, and what does what do the best books tell us, the best thinkers tell us about how to have better relationships with other people. What does religion tell us, and so forth. So you gain some knowledge, and then you start developing skill. Some of Dr. Covey's habits are related on skills, on how to develop better relationships with other people, for example. And if you have that desire enough to keep that up, then you build habits, and that develops your character. So very quickly then, here is kind of an illustration of his seven habits, but also kind of a paradigm in that he considers this a continuum of maturity, that part of becoming better people and being more successful is growing up, is becoming mature in important ways. And so it starts off when we're born, we're dependent, totally dependent on other people. Obviously, we can't walk yet, we can't feed ourselves and so forth. So as human beings, once we're hatched, so to speak, we are dependent on others. Not everybody grows out of that dependency at the same rate that other people do. And so some people are extremely childish for years, maybe even for decades, is that they do not grow out of a stage of being dependent on other people. They always want other people to help them. They don't reach independence, maybe in their entire lives. And yet that is a maturity. For it to be successful, you have to mature out of the dependent stage, where you're depending on other people. Within Dr. Covey's theories, basically being dependent also then leads you to blame everybody else for your mistakes. You don't make mistakes. It's somebody else's fault. And so to become independent, the very first habit he talks about, number one, is be proactive. That is, not to react to what other people do in an animalistic way, just, somebody hits you, you hit them back, sort of reaction, but to contemplate and consider what your response will be to any stimulus, whatever it might be, and do it with strategically, so to speak, that you control your actions. He mentioned in the video that in America there have been studies of people who do abuse their children, for example. And the studies show that people who are abused as children abuse their children. Even though they hated being abused as children, nonetheless, that's the parenting style they learn as a child. And so somebody who is abused becomes abusive. And they have to fight that. If they don't want to be abusive, they have to fight that paradigm. They've learned from an early age the paradigm that as a parent, if you don't like what your child does, you beat them and you're abusive to them. So to do other than that requires a paradigm shift for them. But his point is that if you're proactive and you decide that you do not want to be an abusive parent, you don't have to be an abusive parent. And if you are an abusive parent, you don't have to blame it on your parents. You're the one making the decision whether or not to hit your kid and how hard to hit them, you know, just whatever. I mean, I'm not trying to, you know, frankly, I'm a spanker. I'll spank my kids, but I'm not going to do them any body harm. I'm getting their attention. And so there's a difference, I think, and that's what, you know, when they talk about child abuse, that's what they're talking about, not spanking somebody on the backside, but doing bodily damage. Anyway, once you are able to accept the fact that you're responsible for your life, that there's no blaming anybody else, you're responsible for your success, and you have to, that it's your actions, your thoughts, your habits that would determine your future. Now you have a basis in which to become independent. And so the second one then, once you accepted that challenge, that you're in charge of your future, then the next step is begin with the end in mind. And that is to decide, where am I going? So again, that's where you need that map. Where am I going in life? And how do I get there? And so when you start ask that question, where am I going and how do I get there, you're asking, what are my goals and what are my sub-goals, basically? What sub-goals do I need in order to get the major goals that I want to achieve in my life? And until you have those, then it's hard to progress. But the third item then in this private victory, he calls it, is the putting first things first. And that's a matter of time management, largely. Okay, I have 24 hours a day. Now that I know what my goals are and my sub-goals, if I've established those, now how do I use my 24 hours a day to achieve my goals? What do I need to do? And so that's a matter of time management. And I'm not going to go into detail on that right now, but most of us do not use our time properly to be successful. And I'll leave it at that, and we'll go back to another. We'll talk about time management in another couple of weeks. Once you gain independence, then Dr. Covey says, only when you become independent to a large degree can you then become successful with your interdependence. Interdependence means your relationship with other people. And a lot of success in life deals on your interdependence, not your independence, but you can't be successfully interdependent until you become independent. And so you become independent, and then you can start working and be more effective in your interdependence. That includes his habit four, which is think win-win, which is changing your paradigm of interaction with other people from, in order for me to win, somebody else has to lose. This is a competition. So for me to be successful, you have to be unsuccessful. And that's a paradigm that many people have. So that paradigm has to change, and then you have to develop strategies of how can we both win? And how can it be helpful? You know, how do we develop a win-win relationship? As an employer and employee, how do I help you to be more successful, and in the process, you help me be more successful? Meeting with the employees and finding out what their long-term goals are, setting up training programs, helping maybe paying for their college education. Even Starbucks pays for their workers' college education as their way of helping build the trust between them and their employees, a positive relationship with them, get them to be more productive, help them be happy. They get health benefits and a college benefit and an education benefit. And so maybe they don't stay with the company always, but some of them will and become executives because they're proud of the company they work for. I'm not a coffee drinker, so I'm not a Starbucks fan necessarily, but I'm just saying that's what they do. They bought into this idea that a manager and an employee can have a win-win relationship and both be successful. But as part of that, and it's kind of hard to separate these top three, habit number five is seek first to understand, then to be understood. As we start trying to come up with win-win situations, and as we begin building a win-win relationship, we can't do it until we understand somebody. Again, it kind of brings it out of family life. Your kid comes to you, if you can imagine yourself having children at this point. Now your kids are teenagers, and your teenage kid comes to you and says, I don't want to go to high school. I want to drop out and go work become a mechanic or something. And your first response after having raised them and tried to help them become successful in life is to say, are you crazy? You can't be successful doing that. What are you doing, you knothead? whatever, and you start yelling at them because they've broken your paradigm of success, and you're not doing a lot of listening at that point. But if instead, from his perspective, if you were to say, okay, what's going on, Johnny? Come tell me about this. Why do you want to drop out of school? Ask a lot of questions to try to get through to what it is going on in school that's causing him to want to drop out. It might even take one of my son-in-laws had wasn't exactly dyslexia, but he was actually worse than that. He could not read. In order to read, he has to actually, what he found out later as an adult, he has to put a color sheet of plastic over a book in order to read the book. Otherwise, he can't make sense out of the letters. I can't remember what they call that, but it's a very weird phenomenon that he couldn't read, and so he had to kind of fake his way through school all of his life until, as an adult, I think my daughter got him to go visit a specialist, and they found out that there was, he could hear it, and now he reads all the time. One of the most avid readers I know, but it was a physical thing. So you know, Johnny may be wanting to drop out of school, and you don't know that he has a problem that is hard for him to deal with, and he's been ashamed to tell people, or it's maybe something else. There may be bullying. There may be whatever. But until you find out what it is, and then the next question is, you know, if you really wanted to quit school, then what would your plan be? What would you do? And get them to think it through. You know, would you be able to get married and have children and take care of your family if you drop out of school? Let them answer the question, not you tell them the answer. And they might have a plan, who knows? But the point is, until you understand where they're coming from, you can't come to a win-win solution. You can't really understand. You can't solve the problem. And indeed, if you listen to them first, they'll frequently then turn around and say, what do you think, Dad? After you've asked them question after question after question to find out what they're thinking, now when they're all talked out, now they really do want to hear from you. And now maybe your suggestion will be of value. But until then, whatever you said wouldn't have been listened to anyway. So seek first to understand, then to be understood. And synergize, as I mentioned, is how we as human beings can make the whole greater than the sum of the parts. That by working together, by using brainstorming and other techniques, that we can achieve more than we can separately or even as individuals within the same organization working separately. And then the last one around the circle on the outside, number 7, is sharpen the saw. And sharpen the saw suggests basically that you need to always be improving. And you need to take care of your health, you need to take care of your whole being, spiritual, physical, mental, that you're no good if you break down. And so even hard work has its limits. Hard work is important, but you have to know when too much work is too much work, because then you're defeating the whole purpose, for example. But it also has application other places as well. And let me go on here, and I'll come back to that thought. So in his maturity continuum, again, you can't, you know, dependency is the paradigm of you. It's all about you. And thus, you know, somebody else has to come through for you to help you to succeed. And if you don't succeed, it's somebody else's fault. Independence is I am responsible. I will handle this. I will, you know, that's kind of the principle that America is built on is the independence idea. I'm responsible for my destiny. And that came with that paradigm in democracy, and breaking away from the nobility and so forth, and why the success literature grew up so rapidly in America. Interdependence is again, that we can cooperate, we can combine our abilities and create something greater together. But as I mentioned, then that one around the outside, habit 7, sharpen the saw, he says it's kind of The PPC stands for P is for production, and PC stands for production capability. And he says we have all sorts of assets that we do need to take care of. That's our production capability. We have our physical selves. We have to take care of them, our financial selves, our human selves, our social selves, you might say. Some would add spiritual there. The spiritual asset or the physical asset can be your own physical self, but it also be something physical that you own. For example, a washing machine, a lawnmower, a dryer. Physical assets as a manager include are those sorts of things, machinery. He uses an example of a lawnmower. He bought a lawnmower and he worked it for a couple of years, and he never bothered to take it in to work to do any mechanical work on it, to sharpen the blades or anything. And so after 2 years, it wasn't working very well, and by then he took it in and they said, throw it away, it's dead. Basically, you've destroyed this lawnmower. Well, he realized that a lot of our physical assets are like that. If we don't take care of them, then they're not going to last as long, and we end up paying more money to buy a new one to replace them because we haven't taken care of the production capability. We haven't sharpened the blade or whatever it might be. Financial assets, they're important, but they're, we want to make sure that we have savings and stuff like that, that we're investing properly. So that we have more options and that we're not just always scrambling to pay our bills and stuff. But the most important one is the human asset. The PPC balance is equally fundamental, but even more important because people control both the physical and financial assets. So the human assets are more important than the physical or the financial. He uses as an example, again, of physical. It's a physical example in the sense of a machine, but let's say you work for a company and you're in the production area of the company and you have this big machine that you depend on, and so you're using that machine. You decide to hire a few more employees and keep that machine going day and night to put out more and more product, more and more product, more and more product, and the company says, wow, you're amazing, you're the most productive manager we've ever had. And then the machine breaks down because you haven't assigned any time to enhance the production capability. You haven't taken care of the machine, and now you're producing nothing. And now they're going to have to invest in another $1 million machine. Now how popular are you with the company? Not very popular. And so it's the same thing with ourselves, however. If we take care of our own production capability, then we will be more productive, and the ultimate achievement will be greater if we know how to make a balance of hard work and self-improvement. Is basically kind of PPC, production and production capability. Make ourselves more effective, more efficient, and then actually put it to work and actually work hard using our human talents. So. Okay, we just have a few minutes, there were a couple of things I did not, that I kind of skimmed over. Going back to the idea then of shifting our paradigms and so forth, he tells a story in his book about, and it's a true story, by the way, there were a couple of battleships out sailing through a storm. Very foggy, stormy. They couldn't see very much, and so the captain was on the deck, making sure that everything went okay. And pretty soon, one of the seamen yells out from outside, he sees a light ahead of him, and it seems to be coming straight towards them. And the captain verifies this. You sure it's not veering off to a side? He says, no, it's coming straight at us, sir. And so they get the signal out. In those days, the lights where they would flash Morse code or whatever, and they started signaling this other ship. And he says, turn to your left 6 degrees or whatever. And they get a signal back. You turn to the right 6 degrees. And the captain's a little perturbed about this. And so he says, well, signal them that I'm a captain and that they should turn to the left 6 degrees. And they get a signal back. I'm a seaman first class. You turn to the right 6 degrees. Now the captain's really mad that he's being told what to do by a seaman first class. And he says, tell him we're a battleship. So they signal, we're a battleship. And they get a signal back, we're a lighthouse. Sudden paradigm shift for everybody. But because that lighthouse isn't going to change its direction. A lighthouse, if you're not familiar with that term, is usually a tall tower with lights so that ships don't go aground against, where the lighthouse is at. So Covey says the principles, not only is that an example of a paradigm shift, when you realize that you're trying to tell a lighthouse to move, but it's also an example of, he thinks, a metaphor for principles. That, as I said before, he considers principles of human interaction as powerful as gravity. That it's there's physical, there's laws of physics, laws of science, and there's laws of human interaction. And he believes that if we don't live by the laws of human interaction, it's like us trying to tell a lighthouse to change course. That it's not going to be very successful. That we need to understand that we need to live by those laws, those principles, and take advantage of them. In trying to change our lives to be successful and to take advantage of those laws of human interaction, he makes the comparison of like sending somebody to the moon. The law of gravity, you have to deal with it. The law of gravity requires a lot of effort at first, a lot of effort. In building a habit, it usually takes about 30 days to build a habit to a fairly successful level. So you have to work really hard for the first 30 days until pretty soon you don't have to think about doing something over and over again because you now have done it every day for 30 days and you just accept it as a habit in your life. But it takes a lot of effort during those first 30 days. Going to the moon takes a lot of effort until you escape from Earth's gravity. You're spending a lot more energy during the blast off on a trip to the moon. During the first 10% or so of your trip, you're spending a lot more energy than all the rest of your trip, because you have to break away from Earth's gravity. And then once you're away from the gravity, now it takes very little energy to get to the moon. So you get to the moon, you do what you're going to do, and then you actually let the Earth's gravity kind of bring you back. And so the Earth's gravity now serves you as you start coming back to Earth, and now you're starting to rotate the Earth, and you start moving into the atmosphere and land successfully back on Earth again. So the hardest part is the first part of making a change. When you're dealing with your own lives and making yourselves more successful, and you have to recognize then that as you're applying these principles in your lives, it may take a large effort at first in order to make them habits. But after they become habits, then they seem like they're easy at that point. Okay, I think that covers the most things I needed to cover. There is still on your e-learning site, on the Moodle site, hopefully you're doing the weekly quizzes. There'll be another one put up for this week in the next probably, I have another class this afternoon, so it might be tomorrow before I put that up. but you'll have a new quiz they're not worth a lot, but it's important for you to go through the quizzes, and those quizzes will reappear later in the final exam and so forth. So it's important that you be aware of those. It's also important that you be doing your weekly journal entries. I put up in this week's content for our Moodle site today an explanation and an example of self-reflective writing. Please listen up. We're almost done. So there's an explanation and some examples of self-reflective writing in case you're not quite sure how to write your journal entries. It's not perfect because it's written as if you were just sitting down and writing the entire self-reflective piece all at one time, and that's not what we're having you do. At the end of the semester, however, one thing that does mention that it will be true is that when you're all done with your weekly entries, then at the end of the semester, you'll write an introduction and you'll write a conclusion. But you can't really write either one until you kind of get a sense of what's happening during the semester. So you make your weekly entries of what you experienced in class, what you experienced in your reading and your watching the videos and so forth. And then you reflect on that, what you think was important to you individually, how you want to apply it in your lives. That's your self-reflection. So every week you write those 200 words or so, which should not be real hard. Like I said before, if you're watching all the videos, a lot of them are short, but there's probably another, I forget, I'll be putting up, again, I put them in the other groups. Your videos I'll probably put up tonight or tomorrow. Anyway, so there's maybe another 6 videos to watch, all of them quite short, or most of them quite short, all together adding up to about 45 minutes or something of additional videos to watch. As you're listening in class, of course, this video of this class will also go on there. So as you listen to videos, you can write down the ideas that you think are important, write down how you might apply them, and that becomes your entry. It should not be that hard for you to do. So hopefully you'll be successful. If anybody's having any problems with Moodle, please let me know. I'll help you. Somebody came up yesterday and they pointed out that in the self-reflection box, whatever you want to call it, they were having some trouble with their mobile device in responding to it. But once they went to a laptop, it did work better. But also, I had failed to give you an option of just writing it into, I failed to click a box that then made a text box available to you so you could write it or cut and paste it right into the box. That will be there. I think I did change it so you have the text box available now under group 2. But if not, I'll take care of that this afternoon or this evening or tomorrow morning, sometime the next day, next 24 hours, that'll be done too, along with the new assignments. Any questions? Okay, thank you. Have a good day.